So this here is a tardigrade under the microscope. They're also known as water bears. And today in this video, I'm going to show you how I caught it and where I found it.
Yeah, so hi, hello and welcome again. Microbehunter here. Now I'm on my way to this pond over there. Do you see that? Well, I would like to collect a water sample, of course. It's kind of cold today, so I'm a little bit worried that the pond might be frozen. We're gonna see. We're gonna see. Yes, I think it does look a little bit frozen. Maybe I have to break through the ice to reach the water.
Yeah. Not such a good place here.
Over here I did find a place where it's not frozen, so I'm quite lucky. Look here, yeah, there is still some liquid water here.
The only problem is it's very difficult to reach. It's kind of difficult to reach.
Yeah, over there, in the distance, it's still ice, and here, not easily possible. But I did find something else. I think that's much better.
So I'm going to take along a little bit some sand. Maybe there's gonna be something interesting between the sand grains.
Okay, and I've also found a second sample. I found a little bit of moss here, so I'll take it along as well. Yeah, we're gonna see.
Now, if you want to collect water samples, I always recommend that you take some sediment from the bottom of the pond. You're not going to find so many microorganisms in the water itself. In most cases, they collect there where there is food, and that's usually at the bottom of the pond. Usually, in the biofilm that sometimes forms on the surface of rocks. Over here I did find now also another place which is more accessible. Unfortunately, I only have two plastic tubes, so I'm not able to take any samples along from here. But I think two will be enough, and then we're gonna see how successful today's sampling day is going to be. Well, actually, I've only spent here 10 minutes and now it's freezing cold. My fingers are already starting to feel numb. So I think I'm gonna go back home.
So now I'm back at home again. Here, this is the first sample. That's the sample with the sand. Yeah, and I think we're just going to put it under the microscope first. So I'm going to take out a sand sample here. And we can be a little bit generous here. You see that I cut off the tip a little bit to make the diameter of the pipette a little bit larger. And let's simply put a little bit on the slide here. This is, of course, going to be too thick because the cover glass will not be able to stay on the sand. It's going to be too thick. So I have to push the sand now to the side. I'm doing it like this. I just basically push the sand to the side. And then I simply lower the cover glass on top. And that's pretty much it. I'm going to allow the water simply to spread by capillary action. And I think we're almost ready to go, but I think I'm first going to remove the sand here. Otherwise, there's the danger that the microscope objective is going to touch the sand, and I don't want that. So I'm going to use a little bit of tissue paper for that purpose, and let's simply wipe it off. Okay, that's all that we have to do, and we go now under the microscope. Yep, and it didn't take long here. Look here, there are already two ciliates here. You see that even in winter time, there are microorganisms obviously alive. Living in the so-called interstitial spaces of the sand. These are the spaces between the sand grains. Large surface area, of course, plenty of food. Maybe I'm going to go up a little bit with the magnification. Let's have a closer look. Yep, here we go again. Now, It's a little bit better. Yeah, it's looking for food, obviously. And I can imagine that after a few days, there are going to be yet more of these microorganisms visible as they start to now reproduce, because right now the sample is at room temperature. Well, there's also some movement going on here. This is a nematode worm, a little bit difficult to see as well, but these tiny worms are also quite common. Yeah, here completely covered up now by the debris and the sand grains and whatever is in there. But this is a worm. If you're lucky, then we're able to see it. Yeah, occasionally you're able to see a little tip of the worm. Yeah, here we have again our little ciliate. Yeah. You can see that it's a little bit green on the inside, the cell, and that's because of the food that it eats. So if it eats a lot of green algae, then of course the cell will also turn green. And of course there are diatoms. This one here is an empty one. It's a diatom shell, but there are also live ones, and I've already seen a few of them actually glide. Yeah, and every time when there's something moving, like over here, then we have to take a closer look and we have to be a little bit patient because maybe it's going to be something interesting. Right here in the center, a couple of moving sand grains or algae or simply some decomposing material. Let's wait and let's find out what it is. Yep, and now we know what it is. It's a diatom, a tiny one. You can see on the left side. And this tiny diatom was pulling along this huge particle. Yep, and now we've got two of them. It's a little bit out of focus. So that's a nice ciliate here. So the name of this algae here, it's a green algae, the name is called Desmodesmus. It's a fairly common observation. For whatever reason, they always appear in groups of four, and the two outermost cells, they always have these long extensions here. Yeah, quite nice that I was able to find them also here. Yeah, so what is the summary? Besides those green algae, several diatom shells, of course, whole bunch of ciliates, not a whole bunch of them, but a couple of them. At least I found also a nematode worm, which was kind of hiding a little bit behind some debris. And here in the background, if you look carefully, you see those tiny dots that are moving. Yeah, in many cases, these are also bacteria. Yeah, so there are also plenty of bacteria in the sand sample here. Yeah, so I think what I'm going to do now is I'm going to move on to the next sample and let's put the moss under the microscope. Now, in order to put the moss under the microscope, I first have to add a little bit of water and keep it moist for a couple of hours, because then any microorganisms and hopefully also tardigrades, I'm not sure, right, will come back to life. And even though the moss sample was not completely dry, I think it's a good idea to still add a little bit of water and give it a few hours, and then we're going to hopefully be able to find a little bit more. So let's do that. Let's add a little bit of water to the moss. And let's simply be patient now. So lid goes on top to prevent evaporation. Yeah, well, I was not patient enough. I immediately put some small water sample from the moss under the microscope, and look at this little friend here right in the center. Yeah, we've already seen before. Yeah. Otherwise, I did not find a lot of movement in here. Maybe I really do have to be a bit more patient and wait until tomorrow, hoping that whatever microorganisms and whatever life is in there will come back to life again. Yeah, we're going to see. So here we go. So what you want to do is take some of this solid material here and simply put it on a slide. And then spread it apart a little bit, hoping that the pipette doesn't become stuck. Okay, yeah, and I think we're just gonna have a look now. So this here is not a moss sample. One day later, well, so far no tardigrades, but at least I found a few nematode worms, and this one here is actually fairly large. Evidently decomposing the organic material defined there. Yeah, so essentially, and even I found a rotifer and a ciliate. So there are also other living things, creatures in there, but not as many as I hoped to be able to find. Now you see a lot of debris, of course. Well, but if you're patient, yeah, here it is. I found a tardigrade in the moss sample, okay? So we're quite happy about that. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to try to use my pipette and I'm going to try to pick it off and to transfer it to a different slide where there are less soil particles, and therefore I hope to be able to see it a little bit better. So I'm going to go down with the magnification again, and this really requires now a very, very steady hand. Yeah, so you see it over here. Here, that's basically the tardigrade that I would like to pick up using my pipette. Yeah, but this is of course a very risky thing because usually during the transfer, if I'm not careful, I might actually lose the tardigrade. But in any case, I'm kind of happy to be able to report back that yes, this moss sample does also contain tardigrades. It's not always the case because I've already seen some moss samples where there were quite a few of them, lots of them, and then some of them I was not able to find anything at all. But look here, we've actually got one. So I did now manage to isolate the tardigrade. Here now it's a little bit better visible because there are less particles surrounding it. Yeah, and there is no cover glass on top. So I have to be pretty careful that I do not contaminate my objective, because I do not want to dip the objective into the water. Yeah, now I did decide to put a cover glass on top of it, so I can now show you the tardigrade with a higher magnification. Of course, I always have to keep on readjusting the slide as the tardigrade moves out of the field of view. Yeah, in any case, I just would like to invite you to subscribe to the channel if you like these type of videos. Leave your comments, yeah. And for me, that's all I would like to share with you today. I wish you all the best. Happy microbe hunting, as always, and see you in the next video. Bye-bye.